Hello and welcome to Woman Up, the podcast series by Desperate Art Wives. Woman Up is a podcast talking to women artists, creatives, art critics, feminist historians, activists and more. The series was conceived by Desperate Art Wives founder Amy Dignam in collaboration with me, Susan Merrick. Desperate Art Wives is a platform established in 2010 for women artists who are also mothers and carers. Amy's work focuses on domestic disorder, unsteady identity, power and dysfunction. And I'm an artist interested in feminism, language, power and access. In this platform, we share conversations with women that inspire us and our work, whilst producing a long-form content of resources for other people to access.
Hello and welcome to Woman Up, the podcast series by Desperate Art Wives. I'm Susan Merrick and today we have a first for our podcast. I'm interviewing not one, but two incredible women. Zoraida Lopez-Diago and Leslie Deschler Canossi are the founders of Women Picturing Revolution, a project that is organising crucial conversations that centre the voices and struggles of women photographers, as well as currently producing a book on representations of Black motherhood and photography. Zoraida and Leslie are reclaiming and retelling the history of photography to include the stories that are often overlooked and underrepresented. Hello, both. Welcome.
Hello.
Thanks so much for having us.
Oh, you're so welcome. Thank you for giving us your time. So please tell us about your project, your amazing project. When did you start and how did you both come to be in the place where this needed to happen?
Sure. So this is Leslie. And so the history of Women Picturing Revolution actually happened around the kitchen table, as many great things do. Zoraida and I came together when she was co-curating a show called Women as Witness with an artist, Kiana Mestrick, in 2015. So I believe it was the summer of 2016. We've been friends for a while. We're both mothers. We live nearby to one another, artists. And we were speaking a lot about just the incredible photography that was happening in photojournalism, but also in conceptual photography, primarily made by women and usually involving some kind of conflict. So conflict being not just photojournalism, which we adore, but also how women are talking about resistance and resilience and intergenerational trauma in their artwork as well. So we happen to be mothers and we're having conversation on what it means to be a mother and artist and how to navigate that space. And one of the contributors for Women as Witness is Egyptian artist, Heba Khalifa, wrote about being confined as a mother. And this is about 2011. She wrote, with a revolution going on outside of her door, she wrote, quote, the domestic space becomes a site of uprising and resistance and newfound freedom, end quote. So these are self-portraits. You may know of her work with her child, which are quite raw and confrontational. And with her words and pictures, it really hit us. That she was able to get to the core of the hushed experiences of motherhood. So it just was something that really inspired us. And we were thinking about what to do with all this work that was inspiring us other than just looking at it and, teaching. So we wanted to create something that we could, start creating panels and do seminars and lectures around this work.
We were very fortunate to be able to put together a panel at the International Center of Photography shortly after we came together. And then from there, we also put together workshops and classes. We were able to pull together a half-day workshop at Columbia University's Institute for Research in African American Studies. Now it's the Department for African American Studies at Columbia University. And in that workshop, we focused on representations of Black women in photography. We were able to have two incredible photographers join us for our class. One was Ayanna V. Jackson, and the other was Nona Fostein. And one thing that Leslie and I kind of really find to be a crucial component to what we do is to have the voices of the photographers join us and really in their own words, speak about their work and speak about the impact of their work to the people that are taking our workshops or attending our panels or hearing our presentations.
Mm-hmm. So what that means in the seminar, one thing that we do that, is really exciting for us is we will have, for example, at Columbia, we were really very fortunate because Ayana and Nona were both able to be in the classroom, in community with the students. So the way we look at it is we're leading the course, but it really is a conversation. And then when the artists are far away, we Skype them in. So our second, we had our panel at ICP mm-hmm. and then with Donna De Cesare, who's a incredible photojournalist who focuses on gang violence in Central America and the effects, again, of trauma, primarily on children, and also how that carries through on refugee families in the United States. We had Tanya Habjukwa, who was working with Syrian refugees, talking about the relationship between, I mean, her work's about many, many things, but the one we focused on was how the women were using cell phones as talisman. It was a way that they would have the memory of their, mostly it was the men leaving and going to Europe to find work, and how these cell phones became the memento. They would listen to their voices at night, and, you know, the men would have lullabies to the children, would listen in bedtime. And we had Muriel Hasbun, who's an artist who focused on South American.
Yeah, Muriel Hasbun, the project that we focus on, looked at dental records. Her father was a dentist in South America, mm-hmm. and many of those dental records were used to identify the disappeared. And so during our panel, she focused on that particular body of work.
Mm-hmm. And then in the classroom, after that panel, we had a seminar, and then we had an incredible American artist come in, my point, via Skype, so we weren't able to bring her in, Sheila Pre-Bright, who we also featured recently at the Tate Talk with women in photography in London. And she's primarily covering Black Lives Matter. And then our biggest treat, something we're really excited about, was we were able to bring in a young woman named Caldea, who was working with an American filmmaker at the big refugee camp in Jordan,
Zatari refugee camp. Refugee camp.
Mm-hmm. So we had her come in via Skype, this young filmmaker who made this film called Another Kind of Girl that had Laura Dodgett, the woman who runs these workshops with the young ladies, had gotten this into major film festivals, but no one had ever thought to interview the actual filmmakers. So we were so pleasantly surprised when they said yes, and we were able to bring in a translator, Caldea and Laura, into our classroom via Skype. So these are the kinds of things we're trying to do, is opening up the conversation and making space for maybe more emerging makers mm-hmm. as well. So yeah, that's pretty much our format. I think I over-answered that, but...
No, that was fantastic. That was a really, really clear picture of what you're doing. So I'm interested, the artists, the photographers that you're talking about, generally the focus is within what is usually considered the masculine environments, that, you know, the worlds of politics, of conflict, of uprising, social upheaval, or maybe not that they're masculine environments. They are usually seen to the mass population through the male gaze, or through the gaze that is non-domestic. It's such a necessary step in challenging how we view the world. What brought each of you to focus on those things? Well, you know, because you're obviously interested in those photographers, those artists. So what individually has brought you to that point?
This is Zoraida here. I would say, as a woman and as a woman of color, I firsthand know how our voice is all too often overlooked and forgotten. And for me, the idea of focusing on the position of women and their voice in conflicts. Also, you know, one thing that we also look at is women's voice throughout histories, and how we can reimagine mm-hmm. that voice, and how we can uplift and really center that voice in the conversation. Because, you know, if we look historically at where women were during war, during slavery, during conflict, maybe it's a sentence or two. And so we really want to bring those voices forward. So for me, women's voices, I mean, as a woman, it's just incredibly personal. And I couldn't think of, you know, there's nothing else that I want to focus on that I could kind of make work that I want to make work about, and that I kind of really want to speak to, because the gap is just, it's so wide. It's so broad. And, you know, both Leslie and I, when we first came together, we were looking at, Cheryl Wudon and Nicholas, Christoph's book,
Half the Sky,
which looks at, you know, one of the main tenets of their book is looking at when a war or conflict happens, women and children are kind of the first to be affected by conflict. And if you want to improve a country, you have to improve the position of women and girls. So women, a country that has women and girls educated, that country is more likely to have a higher GDP. Mm-hmm. A country that has less kind of sexual violence around women is a country that probably also has like a higher literacy rate, that also has a better economic status, that probably has better access to healthcare. So improving the position of women and girls in the world, it's not just a nice thing. It's not just kind of mm-hmm. something that we should do because it's the moral thing to do. It's the economical smart thing to do.
Yeah. Too. Everyone's life will improve, you know, across the board. Yeah. So yeah, absolutely all of that. And I would say from a personal standpoint, I think both, as mothers as well, I mean, this tends to be more of a personal place, but when you're making work, before you're having a family to take care of, it's a different kind of work. So in my case, I was doing more research-based work, and that would take a lot of time in museum archives or reading and writing. And when I had children, I had to make a decision for me was either don't make any work or figure out a way to work around this new kind of life. So my work became more personal and looking inside my own domestic space. But thinking about the artists in their way, most of the women we were working with, I mean, Heba for sure, and there are a few. But say, for example, Tanya Habjaqua, she's a mother, but her work is more documentary focused on politics. But she has access to women that maybe her male counterpart would not have access to in the parts of the world where she works, right? So those kinds of stories that we see, you know, she happens to be female, but we're seeing more stories emerge of a woman's world that maybe in certain parts of the world that a male photographer might not be, you know, invited. So that's part of it. But definitely everything that Zoraida said, that there's, you know, concrete proof that we all know, and all of your listeners will know, that if women are elevated, entire communities benefit very quickly. So that was just something that we felt very, very just trying to find a way to highlight that and what we know is photography and what we enjoy talking about is photography. So that was kind of our way into that conversation to share with a broader audience.
Thank you. I think there you've, both of you have ticked every single box and reason of why I do what I do as well.
Yes.
We spoke with Shira Victor last year about her work, and she was talking about she had a project at the time where she was involving peace talk tables between mm-hmm. Palestinian and Israeli communities, mm-hmm. and they were really looking at how women can bring something different to the table to look at things different. And she was completely talking about the economic value of involving women and mm-hmm. improving the access women have to all of those arenas. Absolutely.
Right.
Yeah.
And there was a, you know, we did the first ICP panel, International Center of Photography panel, I believe it was the week after the
election.
American election. So while we were preparing this, I mean, I think we had this kind of realistic feeling of doom, but there was also this,
hope.
There was hope. there was optimism, you know, like call it denial. And, but the week, so we had a big job to do, right? So I think we were the first, I'm not sure, but I think we were one of the first presentations in a room full of people in New York City it was tense, right? And I remember that, we had heard on Public Radio International, Gloria Steinem had made a quote on November 9th, which is just right after the day mm-hmm. after the morning after the election. And she has this nice quote that pretty sums it up. She said, when we look at the predictors of a country, whether a country will be violent within itself or whether it will be willing to use military violence in another country, the strongest predictor is not poverty or access to natural resources or religion or even a degree of democracy. It is the violence against females, because that's what we see first in the home, or at least in the control or dominance of females. It normalizes the idea that one group is born to dictate another. And that was a quote that we found that was pretty much sums up everything we're talking about.
Yeah, completely.
And how, you know, exactly. So how we can share more work that's made by women. And I think that leads a little bit to the book project too. You know, how representation, who's telling the story, really can change everything, I believe.
Could you tell us a bit more about your book project then that I did mention briefly in the introduction?
Sure. So Leslie and I are currently working on an academic book to be published in 2021 that focuses on representations of Black motherhood in photography. We have a wonderful list of photographers that we're going to include in the book, and a wonderful selection of essayists that are focusing on a range of topics, including public health, Black maternal mortality, self-portraiture and representations, technology and the role of social media, issues such as Black Lives Matter, legacies, history. It's a pretty wide-ranging book. But, you know, to focus specifically on Black motherhood, I think the conversation is really needed. I think more and more, you know, Leslie and I, we've both been seeing issues of Black motherhood and Black maternal mortality kind of more and more in the media. And one thing that I'm sure all of us know is the conversations are really important, but more and more in society, the things that really stick to people and the things that they remember are images. And so what are those images? What do they look like? Who is making the images? What are they trying to relay in those images are important conversations that that we need to continually have. I was listening to an interview, a good friend of mine, did Barrett McCauley on a show she has in Seattle right now, and she used the term unflattening. So how do we unflatten the conversation? How do we provide the multidimensional language and the space for Black motherhood and images? You know, how do we provide that space and how do we have those conversations in a very nuanced and deep way?
That's a conversation that's really, really relevant here in the UK as well at the moment. Were you talking about that when you were at Tate Modern in December this year? Was it a conference that was talking about the book as well, or was it something separate?
No, we sat in that delightful room for 2.5 days and loved every minute of that conference for the wide variety of conversations. We specifically presented on the book. So what we did was, we laid out a very, it's only a 15-minute talk, but we laid out a very brief history of representation of Black motherhood through just a handful of artists. We started with Ayanna V. Jackson, Nona Fostine, who we mentioned earlier, Carrie Mae Weems with Family Pictures, and of course, Dr. Deborah Willis. And then we focused on three contemporary artists working right now. Andrea Chung, who's doing using photo images and collage work, Nydia Bloss, who you know her work, her work is more about community.
Yeah, her work is about community, but it's very kind of surreal and magical. And then last but not least, we focus on Sheila P. Bright and her work documenting and really creating community around the mothers of Black children who were killed by police officers in the U.S.
So we tried to present a range of ways of which people are working. And I think that that conversation in particular with Sheila's work was something that we could feel in the audience. And afterwards, a few people said to us that was a very needed conversation, especially in the UK. So that was interesting for us because we're really immersed in that conversation. We're in New York. We're connected to universities that have very open dialogue about these issues of race and police violence and Black Lives Matter and everything. And that was really interesting to us. I don't think we've really had a chance to kind of dig a little bit deeper into that, how it felt as if people were hungry to have that conversation. So maybe you can, you know, tell us a little bit. I don't know.
We absolutely need to be having these conversations in the UK and widely, not just in small groups of people, but across the board.
Yeah, it's interesting. You know, it was really nice to have that conversation around Sheila Prebright's work, but also kind of have it next to Nydia Blas, which is looking at Black girls and the community she's creating around it. And it's like, it's very, it's beautiful and it's very deep and it's very mystical and it's very magical. And so, you know, I think one thing that Leslie and I really think about is having the conversations around Black Lives Matter and having the conversations around the killing of Black children in this country, but also having the conversations around Black joy and having the conversations around the beauty and the uplifting of Black motherhood and, you know, the just the joy and the positivity and just really showing that range, because all too often we don't, you know, we don't really see that range. It's either the killing of Black children or the manipulation and the negativity of Black motherhood.
Right. That's right.
And so, you know, I think with this book, we're really trying to, of course we have to have those conversations, but counter that. And like, what does that counter look like? And I think this book is in some ways, it's a real shot at about, you know, what does the counter look like?
Absolutely. I'm so glad. Yeah. That you, said that, because I think that's actually the direction. I know that's the direction that all of our work is. So even when we're sharing some of these, the harder images, in this conversation, but throughout Women Picture Revolution, our goal is always to end the classroom, the lecture, the conversation on an uplifting note. And that's often where a younger emerging or some, you know, unexpected work comes in, because, you know, there's enough of the negative representation. It's, we're looking for those images of joy and of just everyday family life that I think we know were, are, have been, and continue to be suppressed. Right. So that's really key to the work. And I think, and that's the work we're looking for, you know, that we've been looking for with this book and that we continue to look for. And also, we have the book. The book is an academic book, so it's primarily essays with images. But it's just the tip of the iceberg. One thing we heard while we were there, I mean, I think there's room to do a version of this conversation everywhere, but also, you know, to find that work and maybe do, you know, there could be a show of just photographers making this kind of work, with emphasis on joy, you know, who knows, who knows where this could go, but, clearly it's needed and people are we're pretty excited about it.
Yeah. I think that's, it's hugely important to consider positivity and joy. And I think it's something that I personally, I feel that's something that's just going to come out of these collaborations that you have and are growing, with female artists and photographers, because it is generally what women do in conflict, in war, in trauma, is they pull together and they do find hope and they do find ways of pulling through. And yeah, I think,
right. Cause there's no choice, right? There's no choice. Yeah. And I think that's what, you know, at the top, what Heba was tapping into, what all of our artists are tapping into, you know, for when you're holding down a domestic space or you're part of a community or you're just trying to get through the day, you have to just keep on keeping on. Right. So I think sometimes the more exciting imagery or stories are of the battle, which is equally, you know, important and wonderful and beautiful visually, as sad as that is at times, but it's that, that women are primarily keeping it together. Right. So, we're interested in those pictures as well as the big celebratory, you know, images as well. So
I would love to know for you guys what the high points of the project have been so far, and as well as the book, what are your future aims?
I would say, you know, one of the high points was for me that conversation we had with Caldea, really, from Laura Dodgett's Another Kind of Girl project, with the Zatari refugee camp, was really important, because in that conversation, both Leslie and I were really surprised that no one reached out to this young filmmaker to kind of hear her voice. And that is kind of the core of what we want to do, bring these voices forward. And as Leslie mentioned earlier, her film has been shown all over the world at major film festivals in LA, New York, in France. And no one thought of reaching out to her. And the fact that we were able to reach out to her, you know, Skype her in from her refugee camp, was really powerful. And I think that speaks to the core of what we want to do. So that was for me, that was like a really uplifting and defining moment.
Mm-hmm. And that, you know, thinking about where that project is now, and Laura Dodgett, the woman who makes that all happen, who goes into these places and works with local youth to create a space for them to tell their own story, has since grown quite a bit. So yeah, that was a big one for us. I mean, we also are very, you know, inspired by things we see. There was this incredible show, We Wanted a Revolution, Black Radical Women at the Brooklyn Museum, which is this just incredible gift that keeps giving, is the Brooklyn Museum programming. And that was a few years ago. And then we had an opportunity to talk about, how that work influenced, some of the projects we're working on. We were able to highlight some of the women that were in that show and some of our research. So that was a big moment when we had the conversation with Catherine Morris, who's the feminist curator at the Brooklyn Museum, about that work. And then that work, that show looked at work from the past, and then we were trying to pair it with contemporary artists. So that was a real highlight. I would say, you know, that moment where we know we can find an artist that we get to have a remote conversation with, which you wouldn't think would be so super exciting, you know, in a classroom, but when your participants get to actually talk to, an artist about their process and have this informal, room, that's a safe space to have open conversations. That's really what we just want more of. And that's really, I think, what drives us as, educators as well, is creating those spaces. And I think Zoraida and I got to go to London for 3 or 4 days together and sit in an Airbnb and not have to, you know, do anything else except for research. We didn't have to mom, which is, we love momming, but it was really great to just have that time. We spent some time at Autograph, which is an incredible resource, that photography resource there. So little things like that, right?
Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, I will say that, I think at least what Leslie and I have encountered, the community of women photographers, women curators, is so supportive. I mean, we, reached out, to, Yukiko Yamagata at Open Society.
That's right.
And we asked her, you know, to come into our class to see if she could speak about women's work and Open Society and the Moving Walls exhibition that they have. And she was incredible. She actually brought in virtual reality headsets for our participants to view one of the projects that she was featuring in Open Walls that year, Moving Walls, sorry. So we've received kind of so much support for our project and for our work, and that is incredibly encouraging.
It's such an amazing project. You are both also, independently, you're also photographers, both of you as well, aren't you? Do you have time to share a little bit about each of your own practice and what you're currently working on?
Sure. So yeah, that's one thing we want to say is, as Women Picturing Revolution is independent, which means we're not attached to any kind of institution. This is really a passion project. This is our little, our baby together, which, you know, has its challenges, certainly time-wise when we're working and taking care of family and everything. But I think that, it's something we absolutely love doing. So for you, do you want to start and talk about your work first?
Sure. So a lot of my work also focuses on women. One of the projects that I kind of did when Lizzie was talking about, you know, how different work is made before you have children and, you know, how it is after you have children. So before I had my son, Marcel, I did a project where I went down to Colombia a few times, and I lived in and documented women in a maximum security prison in Medellin. And I really looked at the role that the drug wars, the effects that it has on women and children, kind of really circling back to our work, seeing how women are, you know, the first in the community that are often hit with the effects of war. And I also did a project around how drug wars affect children. So how children in Medellin were affected by the longtime civil war in Colombia. Since that, I've done some curating also around women in photography, and have exhibited that work and other work that looks at how my mother first came to this country as a young woman to go to college from Panama, and the work and the photo albums that she made at the time. So I think my work is, you know, it's growing and it's changing. But I know for me right now, this book is my baby. It's my other baby.
Right. Yeah. I would agree that I can't speak for Zoraida on this, but, and I think it's funny, photographers, you know, students, teaching's a big part of my practice. I consider that, you know, the space where I'm the most, in my element and just feel really comfortable. So in the classroom, and I sometimes see when I say to my friends, they'll say, "What are you working on?" And I talk about Women Picturing Revolution, like, "What are you working on with your pictures?" And I have to remind them that I'm a very slow and steady photographer. So for me, if I get a few images a year that are the images, I've always been really satisfied. So this project has fulfilled so many creative urges. So I think when we finally, you know, the whole Women Picturing Revolution, not just the book project, but that book, once we get in their hot little hands, will be really exciting, because yeah, it's kind of abstract when you're just, you know, working on spreadsheets and reading online, but or reading, you know, papers and, but my own personal practice. So before I had my children, I have a 7 and 9 year old Noah and Mateo, and, my work was primarily about the history of objects. I worked in, for a bit in assisting in museum conservation. So I was very interested in, you know, dust and museum objects and the history of objects and archives. And as I said earlier, that kind of goes out the window when you're working and you have a family. And so in 2012, I turned the camera on my family, which was really unexpected for me. And I started photographing the domestic space. I have a body of work that's ongoing, slowly, called Domestic Negotiations, that I thought, in full disclosure, would be more so looking at what it means to be in partnership with someone, marriage being both joyful and, you know, pretty challenging and can be quite difficult, especially if you come into it later, you know. And I have yet to make those pictures. So rather than framing that as a failure, I think it's optimistic that I still have work to do.
Failure?
Yeah, no. I'm thinking about, you know, when you're in the classroom talking with students, it's so easy to tell them, like, you have to do this, you have to do this, do this. So the work centers mainly around family and intimacy, but it's slow and that's okay. But I am honestly, I'm really getting the itch to get back in the archives. Yeah. I've been finding myself going in early to Manhattan, and I'll end up in a library and I don't know how I got there, or like an archive study room. And I'm just standing there going, okay, how can I make this work again? So that's where I am with the work. But so
amazing. I can see a real links with what you're doing in the project and your own works.
Great.
Zoraida, you talk about, you were already working with people in conflict, but also you're going out there and you're wanting this research to be this face-to-face research. I know as a photographer that's often important anyway, but I mean, even in your build-up, you wanted to stay the whole week. I read when you were at the, but you needed to be there and surround yourself in it, and that, like, in when picturing revolution in your project, you are both of you, it's about bringing these conversations out, meeting people, as you say, not just being in a room to share, but bringing in the photographers, bringing in the artists in whatever way you can to make it a real life conversation, mm-hmm. not just two dimensional. And Leslie, you've spoken several times about coming from archives and potentially going back into them, but also moving into a different zone where you work differently. And I completely get that. Not only did I want to work differently because I had children, but when I was in the archives, like you've mentioned about retelling history, you can read and look through archives and often just see all the gaps, the missing stories where the women aren't there. And actually, for us to be able to fill those gaps, we need to be in the real world, having the conversations in the rooms with people, with women. So you just, it's really, I can see this really beautiful cycle with your independent work and this this baby that you have together as well, and why it will work. So it's really exciting.
Yeah, I mean, I remember when I went to Colombia the first time, and I came back, and I was showing, you know, I wanted to get feedback because I knew I was going to go back. And so I wanted to get feedback on the work that I created. And I took it to a bunch of photographers that I just really admire. And I was able to get a little bit of their time. And then, you know, one curator, an art historian, recommended that I speak to another photographer. And so I showed this other photographer my work. And it was an older white man who told me, you know, that I should be able to do my work in 1 week, in and out, you know, not spend time in the prison, and had really offensive ideas that I should be putting myself behind the bars, photographing the women getting dressed and undressed, you know, just really kind of shocking ideas of how to do the work, what I should be photographing, and how I should be interacting with people that are often really demonized without knowing or even trying to understand the stories and the situations that led to women and incarcerated people being incarcerated. Mm-hmm. And so I think, you know, Leslie and I both really want to understand the stories and to sit with them. And I think all too often, you know, people just don't want to kind of sit with the stories and understand the stories and question the stories and think of what's missing in the frame.
Right. Right. And to that point too, and to your archives point, one thing that happens is, in addition to not sitting with the work, how do I say, we feel sometimes people don't want to do the work. So a lot of times it's happened to us several times where people who should know better will ask us, you know, I need to fill this hole in my curriculum. Can you give us some names? Which is pretty offensive. And so that's pretty bad if people aren't willing to do the work. One thing that has emerged, a conversation at the conference at the Tate, was that, you know, there's these missing gaps, as you said, in the archives, that we find it really, it can be really depressing if you think about all the women's work that has been lost. But I also think that it's tremendously exciting to know that there's so much work out there to be found, both contemporary work and work of the past, and to fill those gaps, to retell. But also, I have to remember, and Susan, I'll send you the name. There was this incredible curator at Black Portraitures recently, which is this event that Dr. Deb Willis, this incredible event that was recently in New York City. And she talked about curating, her approach to curating a show was to tell the true story of a female artist. So rather than, this was a female artist whose many of her works had been destroyed over time, a Black American artist. So the way that the show, not the show she did, but a show that curated her work, they showed some of her sculptures and then they showed some of her student work flanking the sculpture. So what this curator wanted to do was only show the existing work of this artist. So there, when you have that experience, you see what was lost.
Augusta Savage is
the artist. Yeah. I apologize, I don't have the curator's name. I'll try to find it. Maybe you can put it in the show notes because it's just brilliant work. But I don't know if that makes sense. What I'm saying is to start curating in a way that actually shows the reality of what is lost, right? Or doing that extra step to find, because her work was destroyed, you know, for various reasons. She was an incredible artist who I believe died in poverty. Mm-hmm. So, you know, how do you not only retell and find and reposition the work and widen the lens, but how do you also acknowledge what was lost and why it was lost, right? As opposed to just celebrating a few pieces. I think about that a little bit more. But that was one thing that also came up at the Tate was, you know, strategies for, I can't remember,
Lisa McClure from Duke.
Yeah. She did this really brilliant presentation on curatorial standards or library standards on how to, for people who may not know how to find work, how to find work and how to share that information in with a library standard. So I got a little bit off topic there, but I think that what you brought up about the archives is, it's really exciting. Mm-hmm.
I
think that was a really powerful way actually to start to bring us to a close. I've interrupted you there, Zoraida. Do you want to continue?
Yeah, I was just thinking about, Anna Fox, one of the organizers of the Fast Forward Conference. Leslie and I were reading an essay that she wrote in their journal about the conference, and she brings up the notion, you know, when people say, "Oh, there's no work of there's no work by Black British women photographers from the 1970s to 1985, for example." And by framing the idea in that way of there's no work totally rejects the notion,
right?
Or the fact that yes, Black women photographers were making work between 1970 and 1985. You just have to kind of do the digging to find it. You can't, you know, you're erasing.
It's erasure, right?
Yeah. You're totally erasing the idea that women were making work during this time. And so when I read that quote, it really kind of hit home and really kind of linked what Leslie and I are doing to kind of a greater idea of acknowledging that, yes, women are out there and they're making pretty incredible work.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And if, you know, if we had all the time in the world, we would be trying to get into every, you know, anyone that would have us, we would come and be so happy to do presentations about, you know, any topic of choice, because there's just, the work is being made. So either it's, you know, documentary work or fine art or conceptual work, or it's out there. And I think that's, you know, I think we all of us on this call share this mission clearly, with this podcast as well.
Absolutely. What an amazing place to finish, I think. Thank you both so much for your time and for that incredible conversation.
Thank you very much. What a pleasure. We're honored to be among your podcast guests. So thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you for listening. I'm Susan Merrick, and this was Woman Up, the podcast series by Desperate Art Wives.